another fantastic day of the Mega Online Anesthesia Court. Thank you for the people under, behind all this effort, the staff, and all the other the colleagues that giving the hand, even though not in the front row. I'm very happy today to be with the stars today and tonight. Dr. Yasser Rida, he's a well-known figure in anesthesia and pain management. He's consultant in anesthesia and pain management and head of recovery and intervention division anesthesia and pain room in Hamad Medical Corporation in Qatar, and he will be our moderator today. Dr. Yasser, please, you can start.
First of all, thank you for inviting me for as a moderator, because all the time I'm sitting in the line of the student, and I'm thanking Dr. Saad and the army behind this mega course. And thank you very much, because, you know, even with long distance, we become close to each other, and thanking for the technology and thanking for all the attending. Without their presence, it will be just no success. So the first presenter today is Dr. Ashraf Al-Tayyar. He's a consultant in anesthesia, head of Department of Security Forces Hospital in Dammam. I was just working in other hospital for many years. Dr. Ashraf is a consultant in ICU, ICU since 2009, and was an ex-head of KFMMC, currently head of ICU department at the Security Forces Hospital in Dammam in Saudi Arabia. Also, he's a Middle East representative for European Society of Intensive Care, Faculty of Critical Care, Ultrasonography Section, SCCM, UCA, invited when Focus faculty to teach in their courses, and the founder and course director for Critical Care Ultrasound courses in Eastern provided in Saudi Arabia. He have many publications and shares, mainly in Critical Care Ultrasound, and is a figure in ultrasound. Cerebral saturation, and I was lucky to work in many years for security for hospital, but first time to see him face to face. His reputation is a very good reputation in the medical society. You know that in Arabic name, usually Arabic name have a meaning. So Dr. Tayyar is like a pilot or the fly with us, and he give us today the opportunity to fly with him in the sky for ultrasound in ICU. And he will be the pilot in our trip. So welcome, Dr. Tayyar. You can take off now.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yasser, for this very, very nice presentation. And I hope that it can be a very safe journey. So, and I can be a very safe pilot as well. So about the critical care ultrasonography is, of course, very interesting for people working in. It has to be mandatory in every ICU, especially when it comes to the diaphragm, because diaphragm in ICU patient in general, let me say first that, as we all know, the diaphragm is the main muscle of inspiration. 80% of the inspiratory efforts come from the diaphragm. So around 30 to 40% of time, for everyone, the diaphragm is working. Even the diaphragm works while we are sleeping. And 40 to 50% of the function of diaphragm, unfortunately, will be lost after a few days of mechanical ventilation. Not only a few days, but maybe a few hours, as evidence is showing. And the deleterious effect of mechanical ventilation, what we call it mechanical ventilation-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction, might remain for a very long time, as evidence is showing. One of this evidence had shown that there was a rapid disuse atrophy of the diaphragmatic fibers in any mechanically ventilated patients. And this was found to happen in patients after few hours of mechanical ventilation. Not as people believe that this might take time, no. 25% of the cross-sectional area of diaphragm might be lost after few days, if not few hours. And the contractile function of the diaphragm, around 50% of this contractile function, might be lost also after initiation of mechanical ventilation. This was proved by many evidence, many literature, proved by biopsy taken from patients that diaphragm during intraoperatively. There are a lot of reasons for mechanical ventilation in ICU patients to be weakened. One of them is, as we all know, the critical illness induced polyneuromyopathy that affect all skeletal muscles and body, including the diaphragm. Not only that, but also a lot of drugs that we're using in ICU affect negatively diaphragm. So aminoglycosides, steroids, and many other drugs can affect negatively the patient's diaphragm. And again, there are a lot of factors, nutritional status. Immobilization was found to be independent risk factor for all skeletal muscle, specifically the diaphragm, to be weakened in critically ill patients. So we have to know how to see the diaphragm, to see and to know if our patient's diaphragm, which is the main driver, maybe the main driver of their respiratory function in their stay in ICU. Let me tell you something, that when the evidence showed that 10% reduction in diaphragmatic thickness happened in around 44% of ventilated patients, people, they might not estimate well that this dramatic bad effect of mechanical ventilation comes from the mechanical ventilation per se. I would say that all modes of mechanical ventilation may be badly affecting the diaphragm. So even so, some of the modes that you might believe, and we believe actually, that it allows spontaneous breathing, it's badly affecting the diaphragm. And then to know if your mode of mechanical ventilation, pressure control, volume control, SIMV, pressure support, CPAP, BiPAP, whatever it is you're using, you have to see if this ventilator setting is respecting the diaphragm and not badly affecting the diaphragm or not. You have to see the diaphragm to see the effect of this mechanical ventilation on diaphragm. One of the advantages of neurally adjusted ventilatory assist mechanical ventilation technology that's available in one of the ventilators produced by Servo-i, that you can see the fourth wave on the screen of mechanical ventilation to be the diaphragmatic EDI, the electrical activity of the diaphragm, that reflects that this diaphragm receives a signal from the respiratory center. And the diaphragm, when it receives the signal from the respiratory center, it contracts. So this diaphragm is still alive or still working. Otherwise, if you look at here on this pressure control, where the patient is connected to the sweat, to the NAVA catheter, which is a nasogastric tube catheter, that has a sensor at the level of diaphragm to sense the diaphragmatic electrical activity and to tell you that the neuroventilatory coupling is intact, or the cycle between the circuit between the respiratory center and the brainstem, tell the diaphragm down the abdomen or lower chest, the costophrenic area, the diaphragm is working. Look at this slide. You're gonna see the fourth channel here is for diaphragmatic EDI, and this is a pressure control. Pressure control of 20 above a beep of 7. And you can see here that the diaphragm is totally asleep or dead. So this diaphragm is not working at all. If you leave this patient's diaphragm doesn't work for a couple of hours as or days, as any muscle, when the muscle doesn't work for few days or even few hours, if this muscle is known to be active muscle, hypertrophy or atrophy might ensue. And this is the danger. Look at the SIMV pressure support, the diaphragm is still asleep, doesn't work. Look at the pressure support. The pressure support, with people believe that the pressure support is a mode of spontaneous breathing, But if you fully support patients with high pressure support, you totally suppress the diaphragm so that diaphragm wouldn't work. And the danger here is if you don't see the diaphragm before you attempt to wean your patients from mechanical ventilation while they were on pressure support or CPAP, you wouldn't know even if you use very low pressure support or CPAP or a spontaneous breathing trial with a pressure support of 8/5 or 8/0 even. This pressure, as low as you can put on ventilator, might be enough to give a tidal volume to patients. And then it can be deceiving to tell you that your patient is ready to be extubated while the diaphragm is not yet recovered. I'm gonna repeat the message again. You shouldn't be deceived by the pressure support, whatever low pressure support you are using in a spontaneous breathing or non-spontaneous breathing trials. And don't be deceived by minute volume or tidal volume or respiratory rate, because the only proof that your patient's diaphragm is ready to start the journey of weaning is to see by eyes the diaphragm working. Otherwise, we see some of patients, while they were doing well on a very low pressure support or a spontaneous breathing trial of 8/5 or less, they need reintubation immediately or after a few hours of extubation, and mainly because of diaphragmatic weakness. So we have to monitor the diaphragm before we attempt the weaning and during stay in ICU, and to use everything possible to still keep the diaphragm working and to keep the integrity of the diaphragm. And what we used to say, that diaphragm should not, you should not wean before you see the diaphragm. The patient should, the weaning should not be started or initiated before you have to be sure that the diaphragm can tolerate the process of weaning. You can monitor the diaphragm by many facilities, but all of them are invasive or semi-invasive techniques. Only the ultrasound is non-invasive. Only the ultrasound is bedside. And it's recommended to be very safe practice in every ICU. And nowadays, the evidence behind using a bedside point of care ultrasound machine to monitor the diaphragm and to see if the diaphragm is ready for weaning or not is in every society recommendation for managing critically ill patients during, pre, during, and post time of a spontaneous breathing trial or extubation. Why again? Because it's safe, it is accurate, bedside, and non-invasive. There are two methods for this. You can use qualitative method or eye polling, this assessment using your eye to look at the diaphragm and to see if the diaphragm moves on a spontaneous breathing trial up and down or not, and to see if the thickness of the muscle changes during inhalation compared to exhalation or not. There are some quantitative or measurements that can you can do, the thickness fraction and the diaphragmatic excursion. Let's start by eyeballing. What we mean by eyeballing in critical care ultrasonography in general is to adapt you to use your eye as a bedside technician, frontline intensivist have to adapt their eyes to compare the normal to their patients. So you know how the normal diaphragm, when it contracts, how much the thickness change just by eyeballing. I can see, and I'm gonna show you some examples now, how the diaphragm can look to you if it's weak, normal, or strong, or hypertrophied, atrophied, or hypertrophied. So when it comes to seeing the diaphragm, better to use the vascular probe or high frequency probe. The right side is much better than the left side, and you can go to the between the anterior axillary line and mid axillary line. You put your probe on the ninth, between seventh and ninth intercostal space, while you're gonna start to see the liver. This is the liver here, and this is skin subcutaneous. You're gonna see immediately above the liver a three-layer area which moves when the liver moves down, and this is the diaphragm. And it goes back when the liver goes back during the exhalation. So the diaphragm moves down with inhalation and moves backward with exhalation. These three layers are the diaphragm. And by eyeballing, you can see the thickness, and you can see if the thickness changes with inhalation. How you know the inhalation? When the liver moves downward, this is the probe knob here. So this is the abdomen, this is the patient face, this is the patient leg here. So the liver moves downward toward the lower abdomen with inhalation because the diaphragm contracts and pushes the liver down. So I see the thickness during the exhalation at the opposition zone, the area between the lung, which comes here, and the liver, which is here. This is the opposition zone. And you see the liver here during the inhalation, compare it with exhalation, you would say that this patient's diaphragm thickness change or doesn't change with inhalation. Like in a muscle, when the muscle contract, its thickness will increase. And you remember this, a rule which applies to most of the muscle. When a muscle contract, its thickness normally has to change more than 30% of its baseline during the resting time. When we apply this to diaphragm, the resting time of diaphragm is during the exhalation. When the diaphragm, when the patients inhale and the diaphragm contract, the thickness has to change in critically ill patients by more than 30% increases. And then look at here, if you zoom on the diaphragm area, you're gonna see this is the liver, and a three layers above the liver, the visceral layer, which is immediately after the liver or covering the liver, and an outer layer, which is the parietal layer, and an inner layer, which we call it the crural part of the diaphragm. So three layers appears very, very clearly just using the vascular probe in the area I told you between the anterior axillary line and the mid axillary line, almost down to the nipple, just above the liver, you're gonna see this three layers. The vision will be magnified, and the image will be signified and magnified if you have media which the ultrasound likes, like fluid, ascites, or pleural effusion. This is the liver, this is ascites, this is the lung coming here, and this is the opposition zone. You're gonna see three layer structure above the ascites area here, which is the diaphragm. I can see, and you can agree with me, that this diaphragm looks hypertrophied. It's atrophied or hypotrophied, and its thickness doesn't change much during the inhalation time. Look at, tell me, what about this one? This is the liver, this is ascites here, this is the lung coming here, this is pleural effusion, and there is two layers, and the third layer is in between a diaphragm here. Is this diaphragm normally thickness or hypertrophied or hypertrophied? Increase the thickness, decrease the thickness, or normal thickness? It looks like very hypertrophied, if not atrophied. And also you can see by eyeballing that there is no change in thickness when the diaphragm contract and pushes or moves down. This is very clear. And this is what we mean by eyeballing. I don't have to bother with any measurement to conclude here that this diaphragm is hypertrophied and maybe very weakened. We zoomed here in one of the other diaphragm, and then you can see clearly that the diaphragm here is hypertrophied. So diaphragm, if it works under stress, like any muscle, if you used to lift heavy objects, you're gonna build up muscles. When the diaphragm contract under resistance or high pressures or suffering for a long time, the muscle will hypertrophy. So the critically ill patient might hypertrophy of their diaphragm if it's contract under high load. The diaphragm can also be seen by eyes when we use the echo probe or the abdominal probe, and we go to the abdomen and we direct our probe toward the cupula of diaphragm just below the liver area. And then we're gonna see if the probe is here and the beam of ultrasound is coming from here, it travels through the liver, and then it can show you, reflect you, hyperechoic line, which in scope the liver or encircle the liver here, this is the typically the diaphragm. By eyeballing, you have to see if your patients are on spontaneous breathing or they are in minimal pressure support, that their diaphragm, which is the hyperacute line here, moves with the liver to move downward. It moves also. It has to move significantly. And then you can conclude that this patient's diaphragm is working. If you're gonna go with quantitative wave measurement, then you have two measurements to do, thickness fraction and diaphragmatic excursion. The thickness fraction, as I mentioned before, is the difference between the muscle thickness during the inspiration when the muscle is in its maximum thickness, like any muscle. When it contracts, its size increases. So the thickness at the time of inspiration minus the thickness at the time of expiration divided by the resting thickness, which is thickness with expiration times 100. Very easy. Normally, the thickness of any diaphragm is between 1.8 to 3 millimeter, which is 0.18 to 0.3 centimeter. This is normal thickness for the average, as per evidence, for critically ill patients and for normal volunteer, healthy people, it might be bigger than this slightly. And normally, me and you, when we inhale, the thickness of our diaphragm increases by at least average of 50%, it might reach up to 75% of the thickness will increase during the inhalation. When we put the probe on the 7th to 9th intercostal space, just below the nipple or between 7th and 9th intercostal space, you're gonna see and measure the thickness, which was found by evidence to be equal to invasive techniques to measure the transdiaphragmatic pressures. Like simply by here, again, you see the liver, and this is high frequency probe. This is the lung, this is the opposition zone. When you see the diaphragm here, three layers immediately above the liver, and then you put M mode here. And then what you're gonna see is muscle thickness change. This is the time when there is expiration. Diaphragm is in the resting time. And this is the time when it was during the inhalation. We take the thickness here, minus the thickness here, divided by the thickness here, by M mode, divided by the thickness here, times 100. If, and again, this is another example, just put the M mode here, and then you measure the thickness with inhalation. How I would know the inhalation in M mode? Without respiratory cycle and monitor, during inhalation, the size of the pleural effusion will look bigger and deeper here. This is the inhalation time. This is the exhalation time. You can notice when the patient's diaphragm moves down and you freeze and you measure the thickness with inhalation and thickness with exhalation. Look at here, if you don't have, and you don't know how to use your M mode, but this is very easy, you can use eyeballing again. You put the M mode and measure when the diaphragm is down and the size of the pleural effusion is bigger. This is the time with inhalation, and you see when the patient's diaphragm is during the exhalation, and take the difference and again divide by the thickness during the exhalation, and it will give you percentage. If this percentage thickness fraction increases by more than 30%, this was very sensitive and very specific for successive weaning. What we mean by diaphragmatic excursion? Excursion means how far the diaphragm moves toward the probe of ultrasound during the inhalation. if this is the probe, look at my hand, my finger, and you're putting the probe here down to the costal margin through the liver to see the diaphragm. During inhalation, what happens? The probe is here in the abdomen, and the diaphragm will push down toward the probe. Then you're going to see how much the positive inflection of the diaphragm, this is what we mean, the excursion. We use the abdominal probe or the echo probe. And then what you need to do is to fire the mode in the middle of the diaphragm, just immediately down to the liver, and you're going to see the excursion light. If the probe is here, the liver moves with inhalation downward, diaphragm moves toward the probe, so it will be a positive inflection. The excursion is the height of this inflection. So this is what we mean by excursion. As more as it goes to be 2 centimeter or more, this is, will be positive for prediction of successive weaning. If the diaphragm moves with the excursion more than or around 2 centimeters, some people they might say 2.5, and this differs male to female, but in the average, it's around 2 to 2.5 centimeters. This means if your patient is spontaneously breathing, you should not do this if your patient is under pressure control or very volume control or they're controlled mechanically ventilated, because the diaphragm will be falsely moving by the liver when it's pushed by positive pressure during the inhalation. You have to have a very minimal pressure support or 2 TP trial, and then you examine your patient while they are spontaneously breathing or with minimal pressure support that overcome the resistance of the tube. Otherwise, you might have false excursion because of the mechanical ventilation itself. This has to be very clear. Again, another very important factor here, which is if the diaphragm can move around 2 centimeters or more, how long it takes the diaphragm to move this distance. This is what we mean by velocity. Velocity is the speed in a time. This is a well-known term in ultrasonography. This velocity for a normal diaphragm or a healthy diaphragm that can tolerate the weaning process or can tolerate to be spontaneously breathing after extubation is to see velocity less than 1.3 centimeter per second. So that means that the diaphragm can move very fast in a quick and short period of time. This is very, very important. And the machine will calculate it for you automatically. So it measures for you the excursion, the height, and how long it takes to reach this height, which we mean by the velocity. Not only that, ladies and gentlemen, but we can, by ultrasound, using the low frequency probe, the abdominal probe or echo probe, we can measure the inspiratory time. The inspiratory time from this curve is the time when the diaphragm starts to contract here till it reaches the peak. And then when the diaphragm starts to relax, this is the down slope of the curve till the beginning of the next curve. So this is the inspiratory time. Beginning of the curve up till it reaches the peak. This is the inspiratory time. And then you can measure the expiratory time from the peak of the curve till the beginning of the next curve. This will be the expiratory time. Not only that, but also we can diagnose, as I told you, a normal diaphragm, not paralyzed diaphragm, you're gonna see the diaphragm moves toward the probe, which is here. So the inflection will be positive above the baseline. If I see that this movement is in the opposite direction, paradoxically moving, this indicates that the diaphragm is paralyzed. If I see that the line is flat, it doesn't move at all, it means that this diaphragm is very weakened or even paralyzed. Not only that, but also this examination can tell you if you have the respiratory cycle in your machine, point of care ultrasound machine, reflected, and there are some softwares for that. You can bring the ventilator wave to your ultrasound wave and you see the synchrony. Synchrony definition has to be changed. And in the literature, we started to see that the definition of the patient ventilator synchrony started to respect the position of the diaphragm. Where is the diaphragm? Because at the end of the day, synchrony means that the ventilator respects the diaphragm, and the diaphragm is fully respected by the compliance of the ventilator to open the inhalation circuit during the contraction of the diaphragm and to close the inspiratory valve and open the expiratory valve when the diaphragm start to deflate or to decurve from the peak. I.e., in another word, diaphragm in any patients, ventilated or non-ventilated, even if you fully sedate your patients, you don't abolish totally the neuromuscular or neurodiaphragmatic circuit. There are still fires from the respiratory system that reach the diaphragm. And this increases its importance during the time of weaning or liberation from mechanical ventilation. Because if the ventilator doesn't sense the diaphragmatic action, the opposition or antagonism from the diaphragm against the working diaphragm will cause more weakness of the diaphragm. And the synchrony has to respect the diaphragm when it contracts to open the circuit and to close when the diaphragm relax, and you start the second cycle when the diaphragm starts to contract. If you have these two waves bedside during the time of weaning, you would see if your patient is tolerating this pressure support and synchronous with this pressure support level or not. Because what was found to be by literature, that the asynchrony is associated with failure to wean, longer period of mechanical ventilation, longer stay in ICU, and more mortality. And if we can manage to make the synchrony at most, we're gonna make a lot of advantages for our patients. And this can be played very well when we use bedside diaphragmatic ultrasonography, especially when we talk about the excursion or using the low frequency modalities. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, because you opened my eyes and opened the scope just for thinking about other job for ultrasound, because ultrasound invaded our life in pain, regional anesthesia, echocardiography, even ultrasound. So this question for me and the younger generation, if you wanted to learn about this ultrasound for ICU, for general ICU, can you guide us where you can learn, what is the courses, is there any diploma, is there any training thing, or just you learn from the professional, and how can you get the professional?
Very good. Thank you very much, Dr. Yasser, for this question. Yeah, it's materials are available everywhere. Learning tools are much on the internet, YouTube, Facebook, there are groups. And there are virtual courses. We just finished a course for virtual course for chest ultrasonography in acute illnesses. And we're gonna repeat it very soon. We are planning very soon to have echocardiography, critical care echocardiography course for acute illnesses, basic one and then advanced one. And it's a generous support from GE. It will start probably late week of September. So probably 21st September will be the first session. There are a lot of other courses, but they are not very straightforward directed to acute illnesses. So like 1-2-3 sonography is a very good course, but this is general, very general, and non-specific for ICU or emergency. Of course, when the era of the crisis of COVID-19 finish, We're going to resume our very regular courses with WIN Focus and the American Society of Critical Care Medicine, which we're preparing actually to bring them to Saudi Arabia here. And they come to Abu Dhabi and to Dubai very frequently. We can arrange something to go everywhere. Dr. Saad Mahdi and Dr. Waleed Chebel, Dr. Waleed Al-Habashi used to do courses everywhere. And Dr. Saad can tell us that they went to Alexandria several times. Okay. And we can go, we can arrange Dr. Saad, myself, Al-Habashi, Chebel. There are a lot of constellation of well-known people and figures in the field of critical care ultrasonography. And this gives me an opportunity, and Dr. Saad can correct me on that, that critical care ultrasonography has two facts nowadays. The number one fact that it's not like what people used to say before, luxurious or an optional, no. Treating critically ill patients, and there are a lot of critically ill outside ICU, without having point of care, bedside, critical care ultrasonography at any given time of their illnesses, is considered to be a defect in management. This is number one fact. Number two fact is that critical care ultrasonography is a bit different than what the people knows about the ultrasound in general. So when you talk about comparison between, for example, critical care echocardiography, and cardiology-directed echocardiography, there are a lot of changes and differences. We learned this from others, and we are very proud and will be more than happy to introduce the idea and to share in teaching the others and to bring them to the culture of having critical care ultrasonography as a replacement of many other modalities in treating and managing critical ill patients. Like nowadays, lung ultrasonography replaced, I'm not saying replacing, but replaced chest X-ray in many of the institutions. And it's equal to CT. Like critical care ultrasonography, like a transcranial Doppler, you can rely on to diagnose high ICP, optic nerve sheath diameter as well, with accuracy reached to the invasive technology. And echocardiography is among the consensus of expertise all over the world for hemodynamically, all hemodynamically unstable patients, replaced the swing guns, replacing the semi-invasive pulsion technology, Vigilio technology, and many other modalities of hemodynamics. So it is a very settled, evidence-based practice that everyone has to come across.
Thank you for Dr. Ashraf. But we have another question. I think two or three questions from anesthesia-based people because I can understand from the question. One of the questions asking about, do you recommend to do ultrasound monitoring after prolonged surgery before the intubation? In surgery, not in ICU.
The study I showed in New England Journal of Medicine showed that there was atrophy of the fibers of diaphragm after 16 hours of mechanical ventilation. The prolonged surgery, if you are using for neurosurgery or for the prolonged OR time, the diaphragm might be weakened, especially if this diaphragm is started to, or your patient was already with some diaphragmatic weakness or critical illness before surgery. So how many times, I bet you, as an anesthesiologist, you saw people after extubation immediately in recovery area, they required to be reintubated. And the reason was obscured for some of us. Some of this is behind is the diaphragmatic weakness. Yes, if you can do the diaphragmatic assessment for anyone who is ventilated for any couple of hours, it's better to do it. At least you know.
Dr. Ashraf, thank you. And another question about also anesthesia. You know that is there is any information or a study or experience about use of muscle relaxant and dystrophy which happened to diaphragm or not?
Muscle relaxant?
Ah, you see, any effect of muscle relaxant on the diaphragmatic...
It is among the list of the drugs that badly affect the diaphragm, no doubt.
We use
muscle relaxant in ICU, especially in ERDS patients during the beginning 48 hours. And this was found to be associated with better outcome, actually. But the danger is when people go and use muscle relaxant in asynchronous ventilated patients. We see this bad practice in ICU, that we have asynchronous patients with mechanical ventilation. They start with sedation. If the sedation is not enough, they go to muscle relaxant. Why the solution is to see why they are asynchronous and you treat the asynchrony reason. Maybe small tidal volume, maybe because the patient loves to breathe spontaneously, and so on.
So from now, forever, inshallah, I will just examine my patient all the time, just as a matter of learning, a matter to see, a matter of using my eye. Dr. Ashraf, this is the last question about one of our colleagues asked, can you diagnose the diaphragmatic rupture by ultrasound and how?
No, I don't know. I don't know how to diagnose rupture, but I've never seen ruptured diaphragm. Mm-hmm. But as I mentioned, you can diagnose weakness, paralysis, hypertrophy, hypotrophy, atrophy, but ruptured diaphragm, no, I don't know.
So a question for the meaning of excursion, because you know the excursion in heart, excursion in the fragments, and he's asking about this means the depth of movement or the other meaning?
Yeah, the excursion by definition means the height of the movement from a point to the peak. This is the excursion. If my hand is like this, and I have a structure which is sitting here, this structure moves toward covering my face. So the height from the hand down to the peak of reaching the hand up is the excursion. So I look. I put my probe in the abdomen, just down to the subcostal margin, looking through the liver to see the diaphragm, because anatomically, the liver is here, the diaphragm is a scooping over the liver. So I wanna see the cupula of the diaphragm. So I put the probe down in the abdomen. Liver is a good media for ultrasound. So the ultrasound beam will travel. It will reach the diaphragm. And while the patient is inhaling, the diaphragm will move down with the liver down. So the movement will be toward the probe I put on the abdomen. So this will be signified on the screen of ultrasound as upward inflection. This is what we mean by excursion and movement.
Thank you, Dr. Ashraf, again. But you know that some crazy idea came from the junior. It will be a research next day, and third day it will be a fact or science. So one of the scope for that, one asking about, and I like this question really because he opens the gate for research. There is a principle applicable for diaphragmatic status after administration of reversal. If you give a reversal after giving a muscle relaxant, to see the diaphragm or just to open the gate for research or to have an information for that?
Let me focus and enforce on this point again. Yes, of course. Because you reverse the effect of muscle relaxant mainly on the diaphragm, and then you can. But to examine the diaphragm and to see the diaphragm thickness fraction or excursion, you have to have a normally contracting, spontaneously breathing patient. You cannot do this while the patient is under full control of the mechanical ventilation. Why? Because the effect of positive pressure to push the diaphragm down and viscera down will give you excursion, but this is not a spontaneous diaphragmatic excursion. It's effect of mechanical ventilation. If you have the muscle relaxant given And this is the time to reverse the muscle relaxant and patients start to breathe spontaneously with minimal pressure support. This is the time that you can do your examination, of course.
Sorry, Dr. Ashraf, asking you a question, and I know you are just coming from sickness, but this is the last question.
I'm very fine. If you have time, I'm fine.
Dr. Yasser, I have a question.
You have a question?
Yeah, I want to take the opportunity of Dr. Tayar to ask.
Yeah, no. There is a last question here in my list here. And also, you know, open the gate for research. It's very interesting to listen from the people, you know. You know that you speak about ultrasound diagnosis and monitoring. And he asked, is this diagnosis and monitoring reflecting any improvement in decision-making about diaphragmatic movement and the how?
Yeah. A big movement in the management plan is there. If you know how to use the diaphragmatic ultrasonographic examination and assessment before, during, and after a spontaneous breathing trial in ICU patients, it made a dramatic change in the management plan, because you never attempt to wean somebody who is not yet ready for weaning. I.e., if your patient's diaphragm is still not ready by ultrasound, and the ultrasound was tested in many evidence in the literature compared to others, and I personally did a very new study, we're about to publish it, comparing what we have as a settled parameter to wean, which is RCBI, diaphragmatic excursion and diaphragmatic thickness fraction, to the EDI activity of the electrophysiology of the diaphragm, EDI, which is measured by the NAVA catheters, a technology which is in the servo eye. We measure the electrical activity of the diaphragm, as I showed in one of my slides. And what was found to support other, this is, might be the first in the literature, comparing ultrasound to EDI, but the comparison of ultrasound to the RCBI and to the transdiaphragmatic pressure change using the esophageal catheters was found to be the thickness fraction is the best among all other modalities. And the ultrasound is coming nowadays in the evidence and in the society's guidelines to be maybe the first one to rely on in deciding to take the tube from your patients in ICU. This is well evidenced.
Thank you, Dr. Ashraf. This is at the end of a conclusion.
I think Dr. Adel has a question.
Yeah, question, Dr. Adel? Yeah, sorry.
Thank you so much for the lecture. It's really interesting. One related to anesthesia and one related to ICU. Regarding the anesthesia, you know, all of us, we do intrauterine block, and nearly 100% of the diaphragm is blocked or varices with intercaline according to the concentration of the drug and the dose. If we put patient has a major trauma and the hand and or the shoulder, and we put intercaline for 3 days, does it affect this 3 days? Does it affect the diaphragmatic function later on, or weakness, as you mentioned?
Honestly speaking, I don't have any experience with this, Dr. Adi. But the principle is the same, because the phrenic nerve at the end ends in the diaphragm. So if it affects the diaphragm, you would diagnose this by ultrasound. Any pathology, I have a lot of cases, myasthenia gravis, Guillain-Barré syndrome, neuromuscular. Yeah, and I managed them all by ultrasound guidance. So I gave the tensilon test with ultrasound. I have the, I'm gonna try to publish the cases, but yes, and there is few evidence on the literature actually. Guillain-Barré, the other neuromuscular diseases related amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, and many other diseases that affect directly or indirectly the diaphragm. Yes, a big rule for ultrasound, and again, the evidence is coming to show that this is compared to the invasive or semi-invasive was found to be, if not superior, it's equal. So the transesophageal, the esophageal catheters that measure the transdiaphragmatic pressure. Nowadays, people are going toward the diaphragm ultrasound. The beauty of diaphragm ultrasound that you can see, as we used to say, Dr. Saad Mahdi, as we used to say that echocardiography allow you to see morphologically and physiologically what's going on in the heart, we can say safely that ultrasound of the diaphragm or diaphragmatic assessment using ultrasound is gonna allow you to see morphologically and physiologically what's going on with the diaphragm. You can see with eyes the thickness of the diaphragm, the behavior during inhalation, the behavior with the ventilatory cycle. This is life.
And also the second part was about the Guillain-Barré. I was on to ask about the how to monitor and assess the diaphragm in Guillain-Barré syndrome.
What we used to do bedside is we start when the patient is diagnosed, and then when you give the treatment every day, how's the diaphragm compared to others? When you decide to intubate, plus the vital capacity and functional capacity and the peak inspiratory force, exhalation force, all these parameters. And also one of the golden statements that people interested in critical care ultrasonography, they used to insist saying it, is ultrasound, critical care ultrasonography yielded information has to be put in the context of everything. So history, physical, lab, and then what's gonna support your decision at the end. One of the supporter is the examination by ultrasound.
Thank you, Dr. Adel, because you open a gate for me for research, because we make many thousand per year for intraescaline for.
We are happy to cooperate.
But just I will tell you a fact. Usually with ultrasound, the phrenic blockage will be very low. Not than 100% like before. And also with the low volume, because now we injected 8 mil, 10 mil, and we see the phrenic, and I go a little down, more than C6. So phrenic nerve is a problem. But what's written in the literature, that the vital capacity decrease about 30%, but usually not affecting the patient. But I see two patients in my life, it affecting vital capacity, and one about to be intubated. But when I read and some research, I found some phrenic will be dominated more than the other, something like this. But you open a gate for me. You open my eyes to make an research. When I make a block, I will assess phrenic bilateral and we'll see if there is an effect or not, at least for function, not for the effect on the patient. Thank you, Dr. Adam.